Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Bernard Brogan, The Hill, by Bernard Brogan, written with Kieran Shannon, narrated by Robert Bannon and Bernard Brogan. Chapter 1, Inish Fails, February 8th, 2018. Every year under Jim, this is where it starts. And for me, after tonight, maybe where it all ends. Inish Fails wouldn't be one of those illustrious names normally associated with Dublin GAA, hidden away in the junior ranks on the fringes of the city, out in that no man's land between the airport and the concrete sprawl. Their grounds would hardly be the most glamorous either. For team meetings, we retreat to the small old clubhouse. Punters could still be finishing their pints and playing pool while Jim and the management are setting up the projector in a side room. Sometimes we even all squeezed into that bar area and held the meeting there, with lads sitting up on the pool table as Jim has gone through the game plan for the next day. In the dressing rooms, we use plug-in electric heaters to generate some warmth. A nail hammered into a plank of wood qualifies as your clothes hook. The concrete walls sport the club's colours of green and black, but it's some time since they last got a coat of paint. The club's junior team train on the pitch next to us, and as they usually finish up before us, sometimes there's no hot water left by the time we hit the showers. As for the pitch, its sand base means it's been among the most durable in the county at this time of the season, but in recent years it's been peppered with rabbit holes, prompting the club to surround it with a meshed wired fence. For Jim, though, it's ideal. The place has lights, the pitch is never waterlogged, and the club are always welcoming, from its officers to the lads on the junior team who we have some banter with on our way in. After the league final, we'll return to the relative comfort of DCU and the bunker in St. Clair's, but when there's a real chill to the wind and rain, when frost fringes the grass, when you have to blow into your hands and dance on your toes and huddle up close to shield yourself from the elements, out here in Balgriffin is our base, our home. It's been good to us. It's been good for us. We've won 4 national leagues out here, with hopefully more to come. And we've gone on to win 4 All-Irelands as well, including the last 3. Our main challengers may already be meeting up and training away in their county grounds or custom-made centres of excellence. But at this time of the year, Jim wants our training environment to be more Rocky Balboa than Ivan Drago. So this is where we pull sleighs, hoist rocks, chop wood. This is our Siberia. As someone with a couple of young businesses, I'm big into looking up how to develop talent and the right culture. And the Jim Gavin that I know, although how much I or any of the lads really know Jim Gavin is open to question, would also be into reading up on all that in books by the likes of Daniel Coyle, Rasmus Ankerson, James Kerr. A few years ago, Jim even established a team library in the bunker, putting up a shelf in the dressing room full of books on leadership. Extreme Ownership by a couple of US Navy SEALs I found particularly powerful, and I suspect from how he reacted to our only championship defeat on his beat, Jim read it too. We still have an active book club, only now it extends to podcasts, with Kevin McManaman, Johnny Cooper and Michael Dara McCauley regularly making recommendations. And what you learn from material like that is that often the grittier and grimmer a place is, the better. A kid in a Premier League academy might subliminally think he's already arrived, rocking up into a state-of-the-art training facility in a taxi or sports car, only for you never to hear of him. Comfort can lead to complacency. Jim doesn't allow or tolerate that. Think you're a big man? Being called up to train with the Dubs and can now swan around the plush Gibson Hotel the day of a match in Croker? Think you've done everything with your All-Stars and your All-Irelands, coming off another team holiday in the sun? Inish Fails never fails to keep you grounded. By keeping it simple, Spartan, it keeps us humble, hungry. Driving in here this Thursday night, just past the austere gates of Balgriffin Cemetery, I'm ravenous, chomping. There was no team holiday for me this past winter. I passed on it, mainly because I was passed over for a starting spot all through the 2017 championship. I got no game time at all in the All-Ireland semi-final dismantling of Tyrone, and only the last 10 minutes of another one-point final win over Mayo. So while the rest of the lads were in South Africa, on the piss and on safari, taking in the splendour of Cape Town and the Garden Route, just like myself and Kira did on our honeymoon 12 months earlier, I was at home, pumping and sweating it out in an altitude chamber in Castleknock and kicking a bag full of balls out in Westminstown. I wanted that head start because I seemed to be always playing catch-up last season. We had a Christmas wedding, a fantastic day down in Kilkenny, and though I kept ticking over in the gym on the honeymoon and was back training with the group by early February, it wasn't like I could walk straight back onto a team like ours. I had to wait until our sixth league game for my first start, when I kicked 3 points from play against Roscommon. Then, in our last round-robin game, I came off the bench at half-time up in Clones to grab a goal before Jack McCaffrey pounced for another in injury time to extend our unbeaten run to a record 36 games. I got the start the following week in the league final against Kerry, but when 3 consecutive balls were kicked in over my head, it was as if Jim decided I was no longer a starter. I tried everything to change his mind, but I couldn't. I was flying in training the month leading into our opening championship game against Carlo, below in Portlaoise, but Jim saw it as a chance to try a couple of young lads. Neither Con O'Callaghan nor Niall Scully had started in that one-point league final loss to Kerry, but both were promoted to the starting 15 for the Carlo game, while I was relegated to the bench. And fair play to the two lads, they grasped their chance and never let go of the jersey. I came on all right shortly after half-time that evening to kick a couple of points, and the same again the following day against Westmead, but that wasn't long enough of a runway for me to properly take off of the year. I thought things might change with the Leinster final when I came on against Kildare after Dean Rock was black-carded and kicked 5 points from play, but I was again left out of the starting 15 for the All-Ireland quarter-final against Monaghan, and I found out the same way as everyone else, in the circle before the start of training on the Thursday night. I was annoyed about that. Normally Jim would take aside a player who had started the previous day or a senior player who'd have reason to think he might be on. He'd afforded me that courtesy before the 2016 All-Ireland final replay, when I was dropped for the first time ever in championship, but he hadn't extended it to me in 2017. I brought it up with him when we met at my request before Christmas in the Westin Hotel, just off O'Connell Bridge, and around the corner from where he works with the Irish Aviation Authority. I needed to know before I committed for another year. Did he want me back? Did he see a space for me? And he needed to know why I wasn't happy with some aspects of 2017, like that episode before the Monaghan game. Jim, I felt disrespected. I come on and I kick 5 points in the Leinster final, and you don't think to tell me in advance that I'm not starting the next day? I haven't challenged Jim like that before, but I felt I owed it to myself to speak my mind. And I also think sometimes Jim likes for you to have a hard conversation with him, that it shows that you're still passionate and not passive about all this. Looking back, there were times over the years when I probably could have pushed back at managers more. Under Paul Pillar Caffrey, I had to wait until the third game of my third summer on the panel for a championship start, and the match just prior to it for even my first appearance off the bench. I was 23 by then. In years like 2005, and especially 2006, I sat and watched more senior players being favoured ahead of me when I felt I was going better than them in training. Pillar's regime was the opposite of Jim's that way. I tried to stick to the old formula of just letting my football do the talking, thinking that should have been enough. But maybe I'd have been better off asking him what more I needed to do to get game time. It would have put the ball back in his court and let him know I wasn't happy with just being there. In the Westin, I told Jim, I think I've still got a lot to add. I feel fit, I feel strong, I feel like I can offer something different than forwards who are there. But you have to give me that same opportunity you'd give a young lad who's just come in. Con O'Callaghan plays well in training and he gets to start the next day. But that doesn't happen with me because you've seen me for 10 years, so you think, yeah, he's moving well, but sure, I know what he can do. I'll only need him for 20 minutes in this game. If I'm playing as well as anyone in training, you have to play me. And if I'm not playing well in the match, then take me off. but you can't have one rule for a young lad and another rule for an older guy. That's ageism. I laughed saying that last bit, prompting Jim to smile too. Fair point, he nodded. With those couple of businesses of my own, I sometimes try to see things from the viewpoint of others, such as one of my employees or a leader like Jim. Everything he does is with the team's best interests at heart. You can't dispute that or his record. But when you're at the head of a group of people, you can always spot what the person on the ground does. So that meeting in the Westin was a chance to relay how things looked from my perspective. All I'm asking is that if I come back, you give me as fair a chance as you'd give a Brian Howard or Niall Scully or a Collie Baskell. Whoever's going to be best in training, then they're the man for the team. And to Jim's credit, that's the approach he has taken with me so far this year. He's going on how I'm moving in training, and he now has a better understanding of how I view things. That I feel that I play my best football when I'm playing more football, right from the start of the league, straight through to the summer, building momentum, building confidence. The other week, he told me with a grin that when he picked me to start in our opening league game against Kildare in Croker, he initially got some grief from Declan Darcy, his long-serving selector. Why the hell are we playing Bernard at this time of year? We should be minding him. He had to explain to Declan then about the grief I'd given him in the Westin. I went well in that Kildare game. Showed real intent, real desire. I was annoyed I didn't stick my own goal chance away. I always preached to keep it low, yet I struck it too high. But I set up both our goals, quickly flicking the ball off to Dean Rock and then to Brian Fenton as they each made a dash towards goal. It's something I've tried to bring into my game the past 12 months, to be more of a provider and link more of the play. I thought I was doing it a good bit in training last year, opening up gaps and putting teammates through on goal, but I didn't seem to get much credit for it. But when you do it in actual games, it's more noticed. It's videoed, reviewed, dissected by management and pundits. A few days after the Kildare game, I came across my old teacher in St. Declan's and partner in crime, Senan Connell, on Air Sport with another, more recently retired comrade, Dennis Bastic, and they did a segment highlighting my role in our two goals and how my game has evolved. And it has evolved. I've realised that I need to bring something different to my game and to our forward unit. Rather than just looking to burn my man and kick it over the bar, like in the clip they showed of me going on the outside of Mark O'Shea to point off my left in the 2013 All-Ireland semi-final, there can be more value in showing a bit of guile and unlocking the defence with a pass to the runner coming off you and creating a goal chance. A big word for me now is scanning. Scanning what's around you, even, especially, when you don't have the ball. Seeing past the thing that's right in front of you, like the snooker player planning a few shots ahead or the quarterback surveying his options before the ball is snapped. Jason Sherlock, our forwards coach, was excellent at that towards the end of his playing career. Before he ever got a ball, before he even made a run, he could anticipate not just the defender that would be coming towards him, but in the corner of his eye spot a potential runner to play the ball over the top to and put through on goal. In some of the psychology I've read up on, they talk about different quadrants of attention. On the x-axis, you have broad and narrow. On the y-axis, external and internal. Where I'm trying to spend more time is in the broad external space. In the Kildare game, Niall Scully played a ball in from the wing towards me in the D. Earlier in my career, my attentional style, as they call it, might have been too narrow or even too internal. I wouldn't have had a quick look either side of me. I'd have only been concerned with the relationship between myself and the ball and little else, or maybe carried on an inner dialogue about the possible consequences of getting on that ball or not. But the other night, just before Niall put the ball onto his foot, I had a quick scan around and spotted that Brian Fenton out on the 45 was coming like a train straight down the middle. So instead of trying to catch the ball overhead and then see what play to make, I just ran out and cushioned the ball down to him so he didn't have to break stride before firing it into the net. It was something similar with Dean's goal 60 seconds earlier. I fell to my knees after breaking down a ball. I could have just grabbed it and tried to get up and kick it over the bar myself, But with that greater sense of awareness, I was able to spot Dean on the burst, so I just palm-scooped the ball to him as it bounced. I'm trying to be more of a fulcrum for the forward line, especially against mass defences. Back at the start of the decade, when we were playing the likes of Cork in the big games, football was bliss. My man 2 yards behind me and 40 yards of grass in front for the lads to plop the ball into and for me to then swivel or shimmy and kick it over the bar. Now I'm lucky if I get even a couple of yards of space. But I can still be that pivot inside. Because once I win that ball played over the defensive wall, it forces every defender to turn their heads. They all have to switch their attention towards the ball and onto me, which means they've lost track and sight of the men they were supposed to be directly marking. They're scrambling whereas we've been scanning, and next thing, we're runners coming from everywhere, and I'm putting one of them through on goal. Pop. Bang. Tyrone last week would have been a nice game to try that out some more, but I was left out for that one as Jim wanted to rotate the forwards and give Paul Mannion and Kevin McManaman their first starts of the year. But just now tonight, as we've come out onto the pitch, Jim has a quiet word with me. I'm back in the starting lineup for Saturday night's game against Donegal in Croker. Even better, I'm on the freeze as it's Dean's turn to drop out of the starting rotation. I'm buzzing after hearing that. I haven't taken the freeze for Dublin since the day Donegal ambushed us in the 2014 All-Ireland semi-final. Being entrusted with them again is another little boost for the confidence. Even though it's a light session tonight, just 2 days out from a game, I'm jumping out of my skin, feeling sharp, mad for ball. Just before we wrap it up for the night, we go into four corners shooting drill. Just how a forward likes to finish up heading into a game at the weekend, striking a few balls over the bar. The field is alive with the sound of shouts. Here, Fento, and the thud of ball meeting boot. And then it happens. I shuffle out from my corner as Mannion pings a ball from the 45 for me to run onto and fetch overhead. But as my eyes track its flight and I leap, the ball suddenly becomes a blur, lost in the blazing low floodlights. I shift my upper body, trying to regain sight of the ball, but it skims off my fingertips. And then I come crashing down to earth. My legs aren't aligned from having to adjust in mid-air, and my left knee rolls from all the weight heaved onto it. I pound my fist against the turf and let out a roar that pierces the night air. I've felt this sensation before. 14 years ago, while in a heap on Parnell's old pitch in Collinstown, clutching my right cruciate. Jesus, let it not be that again. Our team doctor, Dermot Smith, dashes on and helps me to my feet, but I'm able to gingerly make my own way off the field. As I hobble through the door to the dressing room, I'm met by Paul Flynn, one of my closest friends on the panel. What happened to you? I grimace. Twisted my knee. Paul said what most friends say in a situation like this. I'm sure you'll be grand, don't worry about it. But later, he'll admit to me that my pale face told him something else. Shit. He's after doing something bad here. Normally I make light of a knock. Last week I dislocated my finger blocking Kevin Mick in training. He's so much his own man, he insists even his nickname is Mick, not the customary Mac. And while I was racing through the same door, I passed Dermot Connolly. When Dermo shouted back, asking what was wrong, I smilingly held up the baby finger hanging off me. I'm not smiling now but the knee. And so, Paul stays back with me, waiting for Dr. Smith and Kieran Dicey O'Reilly, one of our physios, to come in and examine the knee. Dicey pulls it, checking the roll on the outside and inside. I actually don't feel much pain, probably because all the heightened adrenaline is overriding and sedating it. And so, at first, Dicey thinks I've only tweaked the knee, but he wasn't on the pitch when it happened. He didn't see the way I landed or how I instantly reacted. He's working off limited information. I definitely felt a roll of something, I tell him. Can we get a scan first thing tomorrow? Initially, Dr. Smith doubts it, but then he gets out his phone and within minutes we have a slot for 1:30 tomorrow in the Santry Sports Clinic. I don't stick around long after that. Darren Daly, one of the most solid citizens of the panel, tells me I'm better off heading away before everyone comes in and asks about the knee. so I skip having a shower and limp upstairs to grab a quick bite, only to end up scrapping most of the meal into the bin. My appetite is gone. On the way out to the car, I meet Jim. You still okay for Saturday? I do a flinner on it. Brave face, positive spin. Ah, yeah, absolutely. Just a scare, I'd say. I get worried when my knee is involved, but I'm sure it'll be good for Saturday. Can't wait for it. I'm trying to convince myself as much as him. But it has happened before where I've gone for a scan and it has turned out to be nothing. And I'm desperate to play on Saturday night. Make another big statement. Well, get yourself looked after, he says. Best of luck with it. Will do. Cheers. But once I get into the car, fear devours hope and I feel like breaking down crying. Only I hold off because I want to call Kira first. I don't want to alarm her. She's pregnant. When I tell her about the knee, she's her usual upbeat self. I'm sure it will be fine, she says. And when I get home, she already has the big bag of ice ready, wrapped in a tablecloth. I put the leg up on the couch, then the ice on the knee, then something on the TV. But I can't even tell you what we're watching. All I see, staring at that screen, is the abyss. That it's already the closing credits. The end. Chapter 2. Wargaming. Sometimes I feel like I'm being buried alive here. Friday lunchtime at the pristine White Santry Sports Clinic, and I think me and the staff here know each other too well at this stage. As I hobble up to the desk on my crutches, Jamie recognises me. I've scanned you before. Yeah, I smile, taking the form she hands me. I've been in here a little too often. My ankles alone must have been scanned 5 or 6 times. There wouldn't be much ligaments left on either of them at this point, with the left one especially still feeling tender. I had keyhole surgery in early 2012 on this same left knee that's troubling me now, and had it scanned again last summer when it felt a bit wobbly, but was ultimately fine. With the club already knocked out, I didn't kick another ball for 6 months after the 2013 All-Ireland final and those 2 goals against Mayo because my 2 groins were suffering from osteitis pubis. Again, they were scanned here, though I'd eventually undergo the knife in Harley Street in London, the same place the celebs go to get their nose jobs and fake boobs. Not every injury requires a scan. Like when my nose was broken again last year after Paul Flynn opened me up with his head in a tackling drill. It's still a bit bent, come to think of it. Where's the number for Harley Street again? But in most cases, Santry is my first port of call for broken fingers, knees, ankles, groins, shoulders. Shoulders for me are probably the worst kind of scan. You have to go in head first, and as you disappear through that tubed archway, it's as if you're being buried alive. More than once in there, I've thought of Uma Thurman in that coffin in Kill Bill 2, punching her way through the lid and up out of the grave. Get me out of here. But now I'm so accustomed to the drill, I no longer get squeamish. And anyway, today I've only to go in feet first and up to my hips. I can nearly set my clock to it. 3.5 minutes in, and the almost deafening techno beat gives way to a different cadence, more like the cackle of an old internet dial-up. So I just lie back, put on my earphones and some Michael Jackson to dilute the droning noise, and count the dots on the ceiling while trying to remain perfectly still. After 20 minutes, it's all done. Before I head out the main entrance, Jamie gives me a disc of the scan, for the record, even though I wouldn't have a clue what I'd be looking at. But she would, and whatever way she looks at me, I suspect she knows something but can't say. But after that monetary pause, she says she'll get that scan across ASAP and further disguises any hint of alarm with a smile and the best of luck. I head straight back to work, where I already was first thing this morning. It's a big day for us in Pep Talk, one of the 2 businesses I founded with my cousin James. We've had this strategy day red circled for a while. We're just after launching in the UK. In fact, yesterday began in London for me before I caught a flight to be back for the session in Inishfails. As well as our 4 founders, me, James, HR guru Michelle Fogarty, and my old mentor David Clancy, also in the room are our top tech guys, Anthony O'Callaghan and Carl Tapley, and our head of client relations, Ailish McSweeney, the former international sprinter who was married to Brian Cullen, our lead S&C and high performance manager with Dublin. We're looking at ways of devising as user-friendly a platform and app as possible for our clients. Take a firm like MJ Hudson, who'd have been at our lunch in London the night before last. They have a workforce of over 500 people. Traditionally, a well-being company like ours would take maybe 50 or 100 of them at a time into a room and give a talk about the various resilience skills they could use. But that's a very sporadic, limited, and passive form of interaction. With this gamified app we're developing, all 500 of these employees can track their well-being daily. They can take part in fun challenges, share photos, and we have pretty cool on-demand content from both local and international experts. We want it to be fun and practical and as engaging as possible. There are great ideas and a tangible energy firing around the room, but a little over an hour after I've come back from Santry, I have to step, or rather limp, out. It's dicey on the phone. I gaze out the window at the Liffey meandering through Lucan, still holding out for good news, bracing myself for bad. "Unfortunately, Berno," he says, "your concern last night was justified." According to the technical term in the report he's got back from Santry, I've suffered a partial, if not complete, rupture of the anterior cruciate ligament. I actually give a small laugh at first. Partial? Does that mean it mightn't be that bad? But no. It means I've done my cruciate. I hobble back into the meeting room and straight away James can tell by me what the diagnosis is. He's done his own cruciate 3 times. In fact, just the other night at the launch in London, the two of us were talking to Eamon Devlin, an impressive Tyrone man who is the managing partner of MJ Hudson Law, and we took him through the remarkably dodgy family history of the Brogan knee. My dad twisted his in his first season with the Dubs back in 74. Keeping him out of the September seminal All-Ireland breakthrough win. Even when he'd get back to win a couple of All-Irelands on the field, he'd have to walk sideways up the stairs after matches. My youngest brother Paul, like James, a panellist in our generation's watershed All-Ireland triumph of 2011, has also done his cruciate 3 times. Our cousin Aisling, who has played camogie with Dublin, did her cruciate playing with our club, St. Oliver Plunkett's. My father's only sister, Anne, has a son, David, who has done it 2x, while my uncles, Ollie, Aidan and Kevin, have been similarly plagued. Even Kira, almost by osmosis or association, has been afflicted by the condition, 2x doing her cruciate playing basketball. And now I've done a cruciate for the 2nd time. Christ. James and Dave tell me to head home. We've covered enough here for 1 day. And now I have some other appointments to make and people I need to consult with. The following morning I'm back out in Santry, and maybe out of obligation to the bond his brother Kevin and my father would share from playing with the Dubs back in the 70s, Dr. Ray Moran has kindly come in on his day off to talk to me and Kira about my options. I'm already quite familiar with both of them, surgery or rehab, having talked to both our physios, Dicey and James Allen, and to teammates who have had the same injury, Mick McCauley and Owen O'Gara, and by text to other county players like Colm Cooper and Henry Shefflin. But none of them are surgeons. Ray is one of the best in the world. I've been over and back on this the last 24 hours. Surgery seems the more sensible, safer option, the same one I chose back in 2004 when the right knee went. But there's something intriguing and alluring about the alternative which the likes of Kieran McGeaney took to return as early as possible to the field. Forgo having an operation and instead compensate for the damaged cruciate by growing and strengthening the muscles around the knee through intense rehab. Surgery means a longer layoff, but less risk of breaking down again. Rehab involves a quicker return, but a higher risk of breaking down again. So the question is the rehab option worth the risk? Owen O'Gara tried rehab, didn't work. James tried it with his 2nd cruciate, didn't work. When I asked them what they'd go for, had they to do it all over again, they both said in a flash they'd go for surgery. Then, when I was talking to Michael Dara, he said I absolutely should do the rehab. It worked for him. What does Ray think? The stereotype of surgeons is that they just cut you open and ask questions later, but not Ray. He says that over the last 20 years in his job, he's been humbled and amazed by the human body. And some of that has come from having seen athletes back performing within a couple of months of doing their cruciate. I get energy from how candid and open-minded he is, but just as Kira and I are walking out, I ask, but if I put a gun to your head, which would you say? I'd get the operation, he says. Gun to the head, but it's marginal. The whole country knows about the injury now. Jim didn't mention anything to the media after the lads bet Donegal and Croker last Saturday night. But word filtered out the day before last, and now every paper and sports bulletin has had something about it and speculated about my future. At 34 in April, is my career over? Can I get back? Typical Jim, he's already looking at controlling the controllables and planning the various scenarios, or as he likes to call such an activity, war gaming. So here at a coffee desk in the lobby of the Clayton Airport Hotel, he has his iPad out and this spreadsheet up with all our likely dates, games and opponents in 2018, colour-coded. I shuffle in beside him so I can see it too, and then I start our war game. Okay, so either way, I'm out for the rest of the league and the club month of April. Say I do rehab the knee and I'm back training with the group in May. You're probably not going to play me in the first round anyway there. May 27th. I'll still be too far behind the other lads. You still probably won't risk me the game after that either. June 10th, Leinster final. June 24th, I've another couple of weeks under my belt. You might throw me on for the last 10, 15 minutes to see how I'm going. Otherwise, you're not going to trust me in the Super 8s against whoever wins Ulster, or a Mayo or a Galway. That's just the reality. There's no point saying otherwise. 5 years ago, it might have been enough for me to say I was feeling good and for you to put me straight in. But that's not the case anymore. So, either way, I'm not going to be of any major benefit to you until the August bank holiday weekend. I go on about how if I had to bet my house on it, I reckon I'll break down again if I skip having surgery. I'm not a freak of nature like Michael Dara. I'm not using him as a data point. I've genetically bad knees. My game is all about explosiveness, short, sharp turns. Very severe on the ankles and knees. Rehab the knee and I might be fine running in a straight line. But when I'm out there against Mick Fitzsimons on a warm summer's evening in St. Clair's, or I have a Keith Higgins breathing down my neck in Croke Park, and I'm trying to shake them off or blow right past them, in the heat of that battle, can the knee take it, or does it break down again? And even if it does withstand it, I'll still have been half afraid that it won't. I'll be tentative. And at this level, tentative won't do. The psychology, as well as the physiology of it all, has to be factored in. I asked Jim to be straight with me. When will I be of value to you? He points to that bank holiday weekend in August, the 3rd to the 5th, game 3 of the Super 8s. There, that's when I need you. The way this new format and these Super 8s work, it's a panel game now. After the first two games of the Super 8s, there's a two-week break before the third game, and then just a week's turnaround from the All-Ireland semi-final. Players will need to be rotated and rested, and if you're going to feature at all in an All-Ireland semi-final or final, realistically, you'll have to have featured in that third Super 8s game. Okay, I say. Well, if that's the case, then that's my target. It's basically 5.5 months away. The average return time for someone with this injury is 6 months. I know that's the timeline Jack McCaffrey is working towards at the moment, but with Christmas in the middle of it, I doubt he was rehabbing every day. Back in 2004, I made it back after surgery in 5 months. Fergus McFadden returned to play for Leinster in 4.5 months. It's achievable. It's possible. We both rise to our feet, rather buoyed by the chat. I now have a time frame, a target. And he has a picture in his head of me playing in that third Super 8s game too. Before we part ways, he tells me to check in with Enda King, the head of performance rehabilitation in Santry, get as much information as I can before making any final decision. So I talk to Enda, and that seals it for me. Out of all the people he's come across who bypassed having an operation, only 16 to 20% of them didn't break down again. Nowhere near a high enough success rate for me. My mind is more at ease now. The rehab would have always been a squeeze. And for what? If I'm going to play meaningful game time for this team, I need to be at the best of my best. At least as electric as I felt against Kildare the other week. Rehabbing the knee just to get to level par isn't good enough. I'm also taking a longer view. I want to be back at my best for the club this autumn. It's the one medal that has eluded me, a county title. And I know people who question the Brogans, and me in particular, for that missing line on the CV. Doesn't matter that we made it through the three finals and were within a kick of a ball of winning them all. We didn't get over the line. And the consensus out there now is that with our age profile, our window to win is shut. But I'm an optimist by nature, and I still see a chink of light for us there. I have an eye to 2019 too. I wargamed it with Jim as well. Say we win this year's All-Ireland. Although as a group we don't tend to talk about how many successive titles or games we've won, the reality is that it would put us within one of an unprecedented 5 All-Irelands in a row. Being part of that journey to try to achieve history would be hard to resist, if he'd have me back. Whereas if I were to now skip and have the op and go straight to rehab, realistically I'd be in no space to go again next year. It would just be asking too much of the knee, with being another year older, for it not to break down again. I've had several pangs of anxiety in recent days as a thought has struck me. Jesus, I might never play for Dublin again. And when I ask myself, why is it I'm afraid? Why is it I don't want it to be over? Why is it I'm meeting James Allen first thing tomorrow morning to help minimise the swelling of the knee so that it's in the best possible shape it can be ahead of next week's op? Why is it I'm willing to sign up to the hardship and the grind that goes with trying to come back from this? It keeps coming back to 4 things. The lads and the journey, the jersey and the hill. Winning All-Irelands is great, but I guarantee you, even if we hadn't won any, we'd be like the Mayo boys, trucking on because there's nothing else we'd rather be at and no one else we'd rather be with. It's the pints together after a championship game, the buzz after winning a league game down the country in the shit and the rain, dogging it out some night in the icy rain in Inishfales or some morning in the snow out in Clontarf, and the deep, unspoken collective satisfaction afterwards. I've made friends for life on this journey. The likes of Paul Flynn and Michael Dara McCauley, who are still on board, and the likes of Declan Lally and Eamon Fennell, who stepped off a good few years ago. Michael Dara and myself were only talking about it the other day, how there should nearly still be a WhatsApp group for every year, that every one of our soldiers through the years should in some way remain part of the band of brothers. There is a group all right for the boys of 2011. A lot of that crew are retired now, and also it was such a watershed win for the county. It will always be frozen in time. We'll always have that bond and those reunions to mark what we did when we were young men 30 or 40 years ago. But otherwise, the only other Dubs WhatsApp is for the boys currently training away in Inishfales. If you came in after 2011, but are gone now by 2018, there's no WhatsApp group for you. Take a lad like Kevin O'Brien, who came along in 2013 and broke forward from cornerback to feed me the pass for my first point in that year's epic semi-final against Kerry. He was central to that score, that win, that All-Ireland, and was hugely popular within the group for his toughness on the field and good humour off it. But then injuries, not unlike the one I've just suffered, meant he dropped off the panel a few years ago. And now the two of us are no longer in the same WhatsApp group. I'm no longer in any WhatsApp group with Tomás Brady either. A Kieran Kilkenny is no longer in the same WhatsApp group as a Dennis Bastic. I don't want to leave our WhatsApp group. I'm not ready yet to say goodbye to the lads. And I don't want to hand back that jersey. Not yet. It means too much to me. I remember when I dislocated my shoulder for the first time after coming on in a trial game for the Dublin under-16s, though I never played underage for Dublin, at least not until the 21s. I had plenty of trials. Mick Bowen would have been the manager of those under-16s, and we were playing Meath in Parnell Park. I contested this high ball with their goalkeeper, and he ended up landing on my shoulder.
I was carted off onto an ambulance and then to hospital, my shoulder feeling every bump along the way before they knocked me out with the anaesthetic. When I woke up, they wanted to cut the jersey off to manipulate the shoulder, but I insisted that no, they couldn't. My father had worn a Dublin jersey. My brother Alan was now playing in one with the county minors. This was mine, even if it was just a number 23. And so, with great difficulty for her and with great discomfort for me, the nurse had to navigate and slip it off over my head. Months later, when my arm was still in a sling, I'd long been discarded from the panel. One of Mick's selectors rang the house, asking for the jersey back. Mam nearly jumped down the phone and strangled your man. Almost 10 years later, when Mick was coaching me with DCU, she still hadn't forgotten or forgiven that episode, confronting him one day on the side of a pitch in St. Clair's. "The cheek of you. Not one of yous rang to see how he was, after he was carried off in an ambulance, and then you ring to see if he can have the jersey back? I can still tell you where that jersey is. When I'd finally established myself on the senior county team, I'd gift it to my close friend Vinnie Terrell, who I won a junior school soccer All-Ireland with in St. Declan's, and who went on to captain the Irish under-18s and play in America. Every September, Vinnie comes back from New York and delights in telling the story of the retro Arnott's number 23 jersey he wears to the All-Ireland. All I want is to wear a Dublin jersey again. To run out in blue and stand to face the flag and the hill and then play in front of it, whether it's just for another minute or another 10 games or whatever else this knee has left in it. As a kid, the hill was a dream of mine. To score a goal into it was as much an ambition as playing for Dublin itself. I grew up on old video clips and stories of my father bearing down on goal and Paddy O'Mahony of Kerry at the height of the 1977 All-Ireland semi-final and him sending the hill into delirium with one of the most famous goals in football history. 25 years later, my brother Alan, in his debut year, would score into the same end against Kildare in the Leinster final. The first Dublin had won in 7 years, and the first day the new Croke Park was pushed to its 82,500 capacity. He still has a framed picture of himself blowing kisses to the hill after that goal. A present Pillar Caffrey and his wife Yvonne thoughtfully knew he'd treasure. So 5 years after that again, when I'd score a goal myself into the hill in a Leinster final playing for Pillar, slipping it past Leash's Fergal Byron, I was overcome. I was so ecstatic, racing to salute the hill and seeing it salute me back. My legs actually buckled while trying to run back out to wing forward where I was positioned that year. Our physio, John Murphy, had to sprint in to inquire if I was okay. "Jesus, John," I said to him. "I just had to lie down. I'm after burning myself out here." I've since scored another 20 championship goals for Dublin, more than anyone else ever has, according to the record books, and it never gets old, especially scoring into the hill. I stood on that sacred terrace as a kid with my dad, then later on with my friends, and our few cans of cider we'd had sneaked in. When Kieran Whelan powered a left-foot rocket to the roof of the Armagh net in the 2002 All-Ireland semi-final, we were among the blue wave that heaved and surged forward, giddy and merry in our teenage rebelliousness, loving being part of this great communal joy. "Come on, you boys in blue. Come on, you boys in blue." Even when I became a boy in blue myself in the summer of 2005, after being called in by Pillar, I'd still go into the hill with the lads anytime, which was most of the time I wasn't on the match day panel. When Mossy Quinn kicked the 45 to win that year's Leinster final, it was as if he was aiming it right towards me and I had willed it over the bar. Seconds later, when the whistle went, a gang of us bolted onto the field, seeking out Alan, and ended up in a photo in a paper the next day. I obviously no longer go there with the lads. Cormac Cushion, Stephen McQuaid, Stephen O'Reilly, my cousin Joey Brogan, Ross McConnell. But I still make sure they're sorted for tickets for any game, and sometimes those tickets are for the hill. Stephen O'Reilly still goes there for every game. The same with some CEOs and serious businessmen I deal with. Conor Brennan, a friend who runs one of the country's biggest insurance companies, Arrokas, wouldn't think of going into a corporate box whenever the Dubs are playing. It has to be the Hill. It's the universality of it. On the Hill, just like in our dressing room, everyone is equal. Everyone is a Dub. Doesn't matter what your club, colour or creed is. If you're a chief executive, chef or cleaner, this is your tribe, your place, where you can revel in some one-liner from an Elfella from Whitehall or an old deer from Cabra as much as a score from any of us lucky enough to be on the field. I'd love one new memory of the Hill, or even better, to create one more for it. Of all the privileges and thrills that go with playing for Dublin, my favourite is turning to face Hill 16 and the flag as the Artane boys strike up Aran Levine. Because at that moment, I'm on the verge of playing football, the thing I enjoy more than anything else. It's when I have the most football ahead of me. 15 minutes into a game and grains of sand are already pouring through the pinched centre of an hourglass. By half-time, there's as much sand in the lower bulb as there is in the upper one. But when we're standing for the national anthem, the hourglass has yet to be turned over. It's all still ahead of us. For me, that time and place is heaven. When I'm about to play the game I love, alongside my buddies, competing in the most amazing coliseum with the most celebrated terrace and support in Irish sport willing us on. In that moment, I'm not really following the words of the anthem. I'm not imagining the boys manning the Barn of Whale or the roar of cannon fire. I'm picturing getting out in front of my man, winning the ball, swivelling, shooting, scoring. I'm like a kid at the front door on Christmas morning. Let me at it. Let me tear into it. Where's my ball? Just give me that ball. Give me that ball. Give me that ball. Give me that feeling one more time.
Chapter 3. Blue Blood.
Operation day, but it helps knowing I'm not alone. Driving me into the Santry Clinic this morning is my dad, with Mam behind in the back. And as I wait in admissions, they wait as well. They know what goes with a day like this. Dad inherited as well and passed on those dodgy Brogan knees, while Mam has been a nurse or carer all her working life. They met actually when he was barely a year back from twisting his knee and she was a student nurse. Dad, a Dub working in Kerry. Mam, a Kerry woman training in Dublin. It's part of the folklore of the Dublin-Kerry rivalry now, not least because of the identity of their matchmaker. Shortly after Dad, as an engineer, was stationed to the small harbour town of Tarbert to help with the new turbines they were installing in the power station, he befriended a local teacher, Jimmy Deanahan, cornerback on the young Kerry team, which had famously shocked the Dublin side which Da had played for the previous September. The rivalry between the two teams was already on its way to becoming the fiercest and most magnificent in the history of Gaelic football. But Jimmy and Dad found they shared something else too, an intense love of athletics and personal fitness. Together that winter and spring of 75-76, they'd power through the sand dunes of Ballybunion and up the hill behind Jimmy's school in Tarbert and time each other as they'd do the fitness circuit they'd set up in the local gym. After one of those midweek runs along the dunes, with the fresh ocean breeze cooling their sweat, Jimmy mentioned that his club, Fenuig, were having a dance as part of the Easter Carnival. And that was where Bernard Brogan was introduced to Jimmy's long-standing friend, Maria Keane Stack, from neighbouring Listowel, who was back home for the weekend. Dad would get to know Maria and Listowel so well, he'd come to call Jimmy Dan Paddy Andy, after the matchmaker renowned in the writings of the town's resident literary genius, John B. King. More importantly, Da can still call Jimmy a good friend. Over 40 years on, and they still chat regularly on the phone and meet up a few times a year. In September 1976, Dad played midfield on the Dublin team that turned the tables on Kerry and Jimmy Deanahan in the All-Ireland final. My uncle Jim was a sub for Dublin that day, just like he was in 74 and 77, and after the game he swapped jerseys with Kerry's super sub, Sean Walsh, dad of Tommy. That night, Dad and Jim and a certain guest of honour hit a Plunkett's pub, the Breffney, on the Navan Road. and there Maria Keenstack was slipped into Shawnee Walsh's jersey and paraded around the pub on Dad's and Jim's shoulders. That would have been Mam. That's still Mam. So vivacious, with a word for everyone and everyone having only love for her. She'd have another episode with the Kerry player's attire, or lack thereof. In 2010, after a Saturday night international rules match in Limerick, myself, Ty Kennelly, Tommy Walsh and David Moran, all of us sons of fathers who played in those All-Irelands in the 70s, retreated to Listowel. We popped into the Mermaids nightclub before a lock-in in John B's pub next door. At some stage, while our generous host, Billy Keane, the late John B's son, was entertaining us into the early hours, David fell asleep at the counter, much to the amusement of Tig and Tommy, who left him there. Being the good Samaritan, I threw his arm over my shoulder, somehow dragged him down the street to my mam's house, and slipped him into bed. The following morning, while I was still out for the count, he got up and was walking around in his boxers in this unfamiliar house when my mother walked in. And that's when a mortified David uttered the famous words, "Please tell me you're Mrs. Brogan." When I eventually surfaced, I found the two of them in the kitchen, having breakfast, getting on like a house on fire. Mam would attribute much of her personable manner to her own mammy. Kathleen Connolly was born on the Falls Road in West Belfast. She lost her father when he fell from a height working in the Harland and Wolff shipyard, causing his children to be separated and minded by different relatives in Ireland and England. Granny was sent to an aunt in Listowel, where she'd become immersed in the local scene, in particular the arts. She loved her sing-songs and her theatre, especially anything her neighbour John B wrote, and interacting with the punters that would frequent the small family shop where she worked and lived. My granddad Jamesy was much more reserved, but he had a gentle, kind nature, farming and providing for his family of two boys and three girls, Stephen, Jim, Mam herself, Grania and Fiona. As kids, we loved going down there during the summer, jumping around on hay bales and helping Stephen and our cousin Neil bring in and milk the cows. We'd play football with the local kids in the lane behind William Street, kicking the ball off the back of John B's pub and the children's clothes store that Johnny Sexton's indomitable grandmother, Brenda, still runs. It felt like home from home, the way they adopted us city slickers as if we were their own. In 2013, only months after I'd kicked 4 points from play in a massive semi-final win over Kerry, the people of Listowel still kindly invited me to turn on the town's Christmas lights. The fact that 1,500 people turned up was a measure of the standing that the Keen Stacks were held in, and my father as well. Because that's another lasting image I have from those magical eternal summers in Listowel. Watching friendly strangers come up to my father on the street, shake his hand and want to talk about those old Kerry Dublin games. Even at the time I was struck by it. The grace and good humour he showed them, the regard they had for him, and consequently the pride I felt in him. I was still too young to appreciate for myself what my father had done. Only that he must have done something good, something special. And I suppose, subconsciously, it planted a seed that I wanted to do something special myself when I grew up. At 10:15 a.m, I get the word to head up to my room, so I say goodbye to Mam and Dad. "Sure, I'll see you later on." I'm shown to my bed and soon I'm watching Netflix. I'm taking this hospital stay as a window to binge on Manhunt Unabomber, based on the true story of how the FBI tried to track down this bomber through the use of forensic linguistics. At about 3:30 in the afternoon, I get the call for the op. I head down with my pillow to this freezing, sterile room, wearing nothing but my boxers and this gown they've given me. Dr. Ray Moran comes in, his usual pleasant, assuring self. "I'm well warmed up," he cracks. "This is my 8th today." The one just prior to me was Josh Vanderfleer, the Leinster and Ireland rugby player. I'm his final one for the day. "Good," I smile. "Go gentle on this one, Ray. I need to be back for the summer, remember?" The anaesthetist enters. We shoot the breeze between questions about any allergies I might have. It's a small world. Turns out his sister is married to our team physio, James Allen. "Well," I say, "between yous all, I'll definitely be back playing this year, so..." It's nearly time. I actually love this part. When they start to give the 10-9 counts and you know you're about to pass out, but almost for the crack, you try to fight it. 5, still awake. 4, still. And then your eyes close. The lights go out. And you just slip away. Dad's people also came from passionate football country, in their case, Mayo. But like so many others from there, they had to leave to find work. And so Jim Brogan from Foxford and Bridget Gilvary from Ballymacullagh, a blink and you'll miss it place between Crossmolina and Killala, met in a ballroom on Parnell Square. Granny was a very unassuming, traditional woman, constantly offering you another slice of cake or top up of tea. Grandad was a Garda, initially by accident. Apparently he just tagged along with his friend Tom Lagan, the great full forward who would play on the last Mayo side to win the All-Ireland and made the GAA team of the millennium. It was Tom who wanted to join the Guards, but Jim then decided that as he was only fishing and working in the local Foxford woolen mills, he might as well fill in an application form too. He'd go on to be superintendent in Cabra, Blanchardstown and Castleknock, and to this day I meet people who worked under him and talk so fondly about him. Cahill Jackson, who runs and owns Copperface Jacks, raves about what a fantastic copper and understanding boss James Brogan was. He knew every one of his men and women by name, carrying around a little notebook with him, so if he ever came across them on the beat, he could ask how they were and how all the family were doing. Long after he'd retired, we'd go along with him to the shopping centre and could get stuck there for a couple of hours for him wanting to stop and chat to every toothpaste or mince pie promotional rep. And yet, as sociable as he was, he never drank and rarely went out. Dad says part of it had to do with money, that once the third or fourth kid arrived in their modest house near the Cabra Gate at the Phoenix Park, they had very little left to spend it on. They ended up having 9 children, 8 boys and my Aunt Anne, all of them high achievers, all thankfully still alive and, as it has worked out, all living in Dublin. Uncle Jim, the eldest, is a trained barrister and a qualified town planner who now runs his own planning consultancy. Ollie has been CEO of ESB International. Stephen manages his own international tech company along with his cousin Ambrose. Benny runs Brogan's, the popular old-style bar on Dame Street, which he part-owns with my dad, and also builds and owns other properties. Francis works for the land registry. Kevin, a strong, fresh-looking man into his boxing and kickboxing, was the one kid in the family who preferred wearing a blue collar than a white one. A highly skilled carpenter who built his own house, he now works as a fireman and as an ambulance driver. The youngest then, Aidan, has worked as a CEO for multinational companies before recently teaming up with Stephen and Ambrose in their tech company. Yet they'll all say the biggest brain of the lot belongs to my godmother, Anne, a whiz at maths, which she teaches in a community school in Talla. Dad was the engineer and the athlete. He won Leinster medals for running, Italian Games interprovincial school medals for the high jump, and played underage international basketball for Ireland, St. Declan's, where he and all his brothers and sons went to school. Used to be a real basketball nursery. He also played minor hurling for Dublin. But when it came to the big ball, he'd have to wait a good while before any county selectors would stoop to coming out to a junior club such as Plunkett's were at the time. And when they eventually did, he wasn't that bothered. Playing football for Dublin was not something he had aspired to. While he and his brothers would go to games in Croke Park, where Grandad Jim would be on duty and lift them over the stiles, he never equated Dublin GAA with great historic days. The All-Ireland win in 63 made no impression on him. His dad, his people, were from the country, and the decade that followed did little to change his indifference. Before Kevin Heffernan, the standout player of that 63 team, came out to Plunkett's old ground in the autumn of 1973 as the new Dublin manager to see him play, Dublin had won only 4 championship games over the previous 8 seasons. Dad wouldn't have gone to see any of their games. So when Heffa watched him play, on a tip-off from a local referee called Senan Connell, father of the well-known Dublin player of the same name, and asked if he'd come out to train. Dad told him thanks, but he hadn't the time or the interest. He was in his final year in UCD, so was focusing on his studies. A few weeks later, though, Heffernan and selector Donal Colfer were back out in Plunkett's old ground in Kilvara Avenue, again inviting him to join the group, who were doing some circuit training out of a school hall in Finglas. His brother Jim, a tenacious back, was asked to come along as well. So, with each other for company, they both signed up, unaware that it wasn't so much a team they had enlisted with as a movement. The setting of Da's competitive debut for the Dubs couldn't have been less glamorous. A league game in Nolan Park, Kilkenny, on a cold, rainy December afternoon. It was the famous day Paddy Cullen and the lads rocked up thinking a decent enough crowd had turned up to see them play the home team, only for the stands to empty once the curtain raiser, a local minor hurling final, was over. For the three men and a dog that did stay on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.